Today, I don't want to talk to you about climate change. I don't want to talk to you about hurricanes destroying our homes, or floods devastating our communities, because you already know that problem. That problem gives me anxiety every day. I'm here to talk about the solution. We're going to be talking about hope. My name is Alba Forns, and I am on a mission to change the climate narrative from all about sacrifice to an actual opportunity. And to start, I'd like to share with you a story. Back in 2019, my co-founder and I attended the global climate strikes while we were in Barcelona. We saw this sea of 100,000 people protesting for climate action. And we felt hope, we felt motivation, but at the same time, sadness, because we knew that the next day, we would all go home and nothing would be different. If you can get together 100,000 people and your best option is to make a cardboard sign, that is the glaring problem. Or, as I choose to see it, an untapped opportunity. That day, Barcelona was just one of the strikes. That day, 7.6 million people flooded the streets to demand action on climate change. That feeling of powerlessness lingered in me long after the protest ended. I started to obsess about the issue, and I talked to people. I spoke to over 250 attendees of global climate strikes over the course of 2 years. And I realized something. People feel like climate change is an urgent problem, but they feel powerless when trying to make a difference. And there is a term to describe this: climate anxiety. Climate anxiety, also known as eco-anxiety, is that feeling of being worried about the effects of climate change. If thinking about a changing climate makes you feel anxious, if you're angry, you're frustrated because things aren't moving at the pace that's required. If you feel alone, like no one else gets it. If you feel guilt, shame, you're not doing enough. I've been there. I know exactly how that feels. And I'm not a doctor, but if you feel like this as well, you probably have it too. But with this, I don't want you guys to get stressed. I don't want you to be worried about being worried, because being worried is actually very natural. It's understandable when it comes to climate. It's healthy and it's even necessary. Think about it like this. If you're worried about something, you actually are motivated to figure out what to do about it. Worry leads to action, and we need action. So, to all of my fellow climate anxious friends here, we're doing just fine, because we actually need more people to be worried about the climate crisis. According to the People's Climate Vote, which is the largest survey ever conducted on climate change, 64% of people in 50 different countries believe that climate change is a global emergency. That is very promising, but wait, because I'm still not done here. Those 64 tiny green little people that we have on the screen, those are the ones that believe that climate change is a global emergency. But 11% of those people say that we should be doing nothing about it. 10% believe that the world is already doing enough. 20% say that we should just move slowly, that we should learn and understand what we should be doing about it. That leaves us with only 59% of those initial 64 green, tiny little people that we had back there, who believe that climate change is a global emergency, those are the ones who are actually demanding action. That leaves us with under 40% of the population. That means that 60% of people, regardless of whether they think that climate is an urgent problem or not, do not demand urgent or comprehensive action. Let me say that again. 60% of people do not demand urgent or comprehensive action about climate change. And when it comes to climate, we need everyone. We need you, we need me, but we need them. Learning how to unlock that 60% is the solution to climate change. And today, I'm going to tell you how to do it. Over the past 5 years, I've been working in the intersection of climate and finance. And if there's one thing that I've learned, is that we need to appeal to people's wallets, not hearts. People respond to dollar figures. According to Professor Geoffrey Hill from Columbia Business School, even those who are not environmentally conscious would invest in environmental conservation if they are given a juicy potential return. With that premise in mind, I decided to start an impact investing company that is tackling what I believe to be the biggest bottleneck when it comes to climate, and that is the climate financing gap. So now, let's talk about numbers. £158 trillion. That is a very big number. And that is what we need in order to achieve our net zero goals by 2050. That means that current financial flows need to increase threefold if we want to reach the Paris Agreement global targets. And surprise, surprise, like everything when it comes to climate, we are not moving fast enough. I started to do a little bit of research about the topic, and I realized that there's three main things that are blocking us from taking action and from tackling the climate financing gap. Number one is the misalignment between the political and the financial sector. We've got policies, we've got regulations in place, but many of them are ineffective because there's a lack of coordination and piecemeal. That leads to an inefficient allocation of capital and a misalignment as well between the public and the private sector. Number two, there's a lack of trust, especially between the global north and the global south. It is pretty understandable though. Back in 2009, developed countries committed to be channeling $100 billion per year by 2020 to developing countries. They have fallen short on their promise, and that has caused a breakdown of trust. And then, number three, we have a lack of climate data. We can't act on something that we can't understand, and we can't understand something that we cannot measure. So we need that data in order to set the right mechanisms and strategies in place, because if not, we're just opening the door for corporate greenwashing. As I promised, I'm not a person who focuses on problems, I focus on solutions, and that's why I want to share this number now. £34 trillion. That is what we would be adding to the global economy if we actually stood up and did something about the climate financing gap. So, let's get started, right? This is the largest investment opportunity of our lifetime. That's why I started an impact investing company, and at my company, what we're doing is we're empowering people to invest in renewable energy projects and potentially earn a return. You might be asking yourself, why is she doing this? The reason is because I'm not going and talking to them about the effects of climate change. I don't talk to them about the climate financing gap. I don't talk to them about the key blockers. Instead of that, I'm incentivizing those people by giving them a potential return on investment. Only this way we will be able to unlock that 60% of people who are not necessarily climate conscious. Like this, we will be able to mobilize the masses. And let me tell you, it's working. Taking one step further, if we extrapolate this premise and we take it to the corporate world, it continues to be real and to work. A great example is the Inflation Reduction Act in the US. So for those of you who are not familiar with the IRA, it is the most important climate policy in US history. And basically what they are doing is they are investing in the energy transition, but they go one step further. They are using that money for low-income families, rural areas. They are creating local jobs. What they are doing is they are actually connecting economic incentives with their environmental goals. And only this way, they're able to motivate corporates to move faster. It's very important to bear in mind that when we talk about climate and climate action, it doesn't have to come at the expense of economic growth. It can actually fuel it. To end this presentation, I want to share with you what I believe are the three key principles to spur behavioral change. The first one is appealing to people's desires, to their passion. Second, you need to make it seamless. You need to make the right option, the easy option, a no-brainer. And the last one is to provide a juicy incentive, which can come with the shape of a monetary return, as an example. Next time that you talk to someone, that you want to inspire someone to take climate action, I want you to remember those three main concepts, and you will be amazed about how well this works. I want you to join me in rewriting the climate narrative from all about sacrifice to an actual opportunity. Now, let's go save the planet. Thank you. Yeah.